criticize religion. This is a really complex issue. Those of you who have debated with religious people, you've no doubt had this asked of you. You know, why do you waste your time? Why do you assault the cherished beliefs of nice people? And it's one that I don't think a lot of people have a really good answer for. So I want to talk about why I do it. Let me start off by saying I'm part of a student-run radio show here at Missouri State University. And because I've been doing the skepticism thing for the last 5 years now, I was lucky enough to get some very prominent atheists to come on our show and talk to us. These are people like Richard Carrier, we've had P.Z. Myers, we've had Joe Nickel, who's somewhere in the audience, Rebecca Watson was on there as well. And before I let them off of our show, I always ask them a particular question. And that question is, why do you criticize religion? Advance the slide, please. Go ahead and hit it again. Rebecca Watson's answer was, I criticize anything that is not in my point of view, anything that strays from the rational, and anything that has the potential to cause harm. So when people use crazy beliefs to justify something absurd, I speak out against it. Which is good. It's not quite where I'm going, but it's very, very good. Advance, hit it twice. P.Z. Myers, the biggest firebrand in the atheist movement, as evidenced by this picture, says there's lots of good reasons. One is that it's a lot of fun. Seriously, it's like going to the circus and watching the clowns. Only the clowns are all over our country, and they're ruling things, and they're dictating how we should live our lives, which kind of takes the laughter out of it. Okay. Also good. It can be fun when it gets to certain levels of absurdity. Twice more, please. Now, Richard Carrier says, one of the main problems of religion is that religious premises are used as the premises and justifications for policy actions and behavior toward other people that actually cause harm. It's not really credible because he's not cuddling a stuffed animal. But that's really what I want to go with this. And to illustrate it for you, I'm going to paint you a scenario real quick. And has to do with zombies. Advance, please. There you go. How do you like me academically now? Okay, imagine one day you wake up to find that your entire city is impopulated with zombies. They've eaten everybody and they're out in the streets chasing people down, blood everywhere, yada, yada, yada. So you're a good person. You rush out to help your neighbors. You grab the shotgun, Bruce Campbell style, and just go to town. You go out rescuing people, and by the end of the day, there's just bodies everywhere. You've killed all the zombies. You saved the town. The survivors are probably going to make construction of your statue their highest priority. But there's a catch here. If just one little fact has changed, if one little fact is different, whether or not they were zombies, if you made one mistake, you've gone from being a hero, a statue-earning hero, to have joined the ranks of some of the worst people to have ever lived. Go ahead and advance the slide, please. And that's the power that reality has over our morality. Morality is dependent on what is true about the universe, about how reality works. And this is called our epistemological responsibility. Go ahead and hit it. Essentially, if we have a conscience, then we have a responsibility to examine our beliefs, to ensure we possess good reasons for believing as we do, to ensure that our good intentions do not become twisted. Like we don't wind up killing our whole town thinking we're saving everybody. Go ahead and hit it again. Steve Weinberg put this a great way, and you've surely heard this quote before if you're interested in the theology or theologian-atheist debate. With or without religion, you would have good people doing good things and evil people doing evil things. But for good people to do evil things, that takes religion. Go ahead and hit it again. In short, it's not enough to have the conversation about whether or not beliefs are beneficial, since that is ultimately decided entirely in retrospect. We have to obligate ourselves to holding the conversation about what is true and what is real. And go ahead and hit it again. And also, this is very important if you're ever going to give a talk. I read it on Google, and everything on there is credible. Okay, hit it again. All right. If you want a real-life example of this epistemological responsibility setup, we're going to go to the case of a young girl named Madeline Karen Newman. Go ahead and hit it. This is Dale Newman. This is her father. Go ahead and advance again. They're a Wisconsin family, and little Karen Newman came down with diabetes, or had diabetes, and it escalated to the point where she was swollen, purple, not breathing. And rather than take her to a doctor, as most sane people would in this situation, her parents prayed over her. And they literally prayed her to death. Go ahead and advance the slide. They prayed her to death because nobody can survive diabetes if it's untreated. But in her particular situation, ooh, God has cheesed off at us. In her particular situation, 998 out of 1,000 people will survive if treated with modern medicine. Go ahead and advance again. God loves us again. The really scary thing here is that when Dale Newman was asked if this were to happen to another one of his children, would he change his mind? Would he change his behavior? Would he take them to the doctor? And he said, no. He said he would continue to put his trust in God over his trust in the ideas of men. And here's the thing. Go ahead and advance it again. His intentions, like the person in my zombie scenario, are pure. If prayers really do heal the sick, then praying over our children when they get sick is what we should do. If he's right about the universe, then he was doing the moral thing. The problem is, he stopped caring about what was real, only that he had faith. And for that, his good intentions became twisted and he became a monster. Go ahead and advance. Now, there's some religious people who will say, I'm taking out one weird exception, one crazy example out of left field, or right field as it were, and saying, this is indicative of the whole. And I'm not doing that. Go ahead and advance. Recently in the Senate health care bill, a faith healing provision was inserted, or attempted to be inserted. This would have allowed people who wanted to go to faith healers to get federal reimbursement through their insurance plan to cover that. Go ahead and advance it again. The same thing was true in the House bill. It was actually listed, and if you read my blog, I'm not sure if that's anywhere, but just Google my name. But I actually put this in there with a link to the bill. You can actually find Christian Science practitioner in the bill. These people are our legislators. These people are appeasing huge portions of our population, and they're doing it for a very political reason. So when you say that these people who believe that faith can heal the sick or prayer can heal the sick are just, you know, crazy oddball examples, it's not true. Go ahead and advance again. In fact, entire religions have been constructed around the idea that faith can heal the sick, including what is the ultimate example of dishonesty in advertising, Christian Science. But that's the premise of their religion. The deal is, these parents, you know, you can read about this all the time in the news, at least a couple times a year, often a couple times a month, where parents pray their kids to death. It has nothing to do with how much they love them. It has to do with they have lost their ability to question, and that is through faith. I mean, can you imagine if prayer really did heal the sick? I mean, we wouldn't even have hospitals. There'd be no need for doctors, right? At least they would behave differently. Go ahead and advance it. We would have situations kind of like this. Go ahead and advance again. The truth of the matter is that we cannot have the discussion about what is moral until we have the discussion about what is real. Go ahead and advance twice, because after all, maybe God really does want us to burn that witch. Yeah, there we go. With pictures. Okay. The people who say that faith can lead us to good actions, you know, they'll say, you know, you can't criticize faith because it leads to good things. And they're right. Faith does lead people to good actions. And if you want evidence for that, take kids who behave really, really well in December to get presents, hoping that their tomfoolery the rest of the year will just go unnoticed. Here we have Calvin giving us that example. And obviously, no sane adult, you know, will argue that we need belief in Santa Claus to get us to good actions, at least in adulthood. And there's a reason for that. We have perfectly good, naturalistic, biological reasons to be moral. Go ahead and advance again. There you go. I'm not sure he ever had Santa Claus in mind when he came up with it. Okay, go ahead and advance again. All right. The timing was completely off on that. I blame you. Okay. One more last example to really drive this point home. Faith does get us to good actions, or bad reasons get us to good actions. For instance, if you thought there was an evil Smurf hiding somewhere in your room who is going to steal your homework, all your homework, until you donated $40 to charity, you would probably donate the $40 to charity. But nobody's going to judge you on your motivation for donating the $40. They're going to judge you on how many people you helped. You know, did your $40 go to do something good? Are you selfless? The motivation isn't really a concern. Likewise, if you thought that same is all to get us to the good actions. So defending faith by saying it gets us to good actions is really a non sequitur. And it really kind of shields the idea that unreasonable actions make completely immoral things seem moral. Go ahead and advance, please. Now, religion thrives on being able to dodge the burden of reason. We've heard all these examples before. Go ahead and hit it. The first one, those people are not true Christians. And raise your hand if you've heard this one somewhere. Yeah, right. Go ahead and advance again. As long as my beliefs aren't hurting anybody, we've all heard that one. Go ahead one more time. How are my beliefs any of your business, except when I vote? Go ahead one more time. Religion gives people hope. These are just the standard. Go one more time. I can't hardly read that. We'll have to agree to disagree. Oh, that's my favorite. One more. Got down here. Nothing you can say will ever change my mind. Raise your hand if you've heard that one. Are you all from Missouri? Because they say that all the time here. All right, one more time. All right. Life would have no meaning without belief in God. And there's one more. It's absolutely my favorite, and I get it in email all the time. Go ahead. And that is, you're a jerk face. They're not always that tactful about it. Sometimes they use language. Okay, anyway. But let's go through these one at a time, because they all deserve a response. Go ahead. Yeah. All right. But my faith is different. You know, those people, those are the extremists. Those people aren't my faith. And there's a lot to say about this. First off, go ahead and advance. When people say their faith isn't my faith, that person's faith is different from mine, I really think there's only two things we can get out of that. The first one is they're saying my faith is more likely to be true than theirs. Essentially, that person cannot have God's will figured out because I have God's will figured out and I disagree. The other one is, go ahead and advance, my faith is not more likely to be true, but it is more benign. And here's the thing. I think once thought out, the second one defaults back to the first. Because for you to know that your faith is more benign, you have to have a truth claim behind it. For instance, if, say, God hates homosexuals, and he's going to burn our nation to cinders if we allow them to marry, then Fred Phelps might be onto something. He might be protecting us. How can you say that your faith is more benign unless you have a good reason to disagree with him on that proposition? And that's just the problem, is that our faith tends to be an equal defense for equally absurd propositions. It's a terrible means of separating things in terms of credibility. And that gets us into a lot of problems. The second thing, go ahead and advance. Oh yeah, maybe God does want us actually to kill other people. So hard to get the timing down. All right, go ahead and advance. All right. The second thing that's to be said, go ahead and advance, is how do they know? How do they know what true Christianity is? In fact, if you go back through time, through what true Christianity has looked like, how many modern Christians would live up to true Christianity by historical standards? I mean, just a couple hundred years ago, or just 100 years ago, you've got people using the Bible to oppress or to suppress women's suffrage and women's rights. Using, this is one of the favorite ones they used to quote, go ahead and advance. I will not suffer woman to speak nor to usurp authority over the man. Go ahead and advance one more. Let her listen in silence. And once more. If you read Skeptic, you know what I'm talking about. The other thing to say is that, go ahead and advance. Is, wait, it's the trademark? Yeah. You didn't laugh at the zombies, but you laughed at the trademark? Okay. On what grounds can a believer rightly say that they have true Christianity figured out? And after we've had a millennia of just changing doctrines, go ahead and advance this too. 200 years ago, we're using the Bible to defend slavery. And this is a straight out of Leviticus. You can go ahead and take your time to read it, because I'm reading it. This is giving me a neck ache. But these are still in the Bible. The passages that endorse slavery are still there. Go ahead and advance one more. All right, go ahead and advance one more. Now, think about all the greatest minds in the history of the Christian faith that would be completely booted out of true Christianity by modern standards. Good. I'm a little bit ahead of myself. But this is a great quote. During the many ages there were witches. The Bible said so. The Bible commanded that they should not be allowed to live. Therefore, the church went about its business and destroyed them. Go ahead and advance one more. I think it's one of the most plangent lines I've ever heard. Of course, Mark Twain has some great quotes. Go ahead and advance one more. All right, and advance. Okay. All the great minds in the history of Christian theology who would be just completely booted out by modern standards. Go ahead and advance. These would include a veritable who's who list of saints, popes, church leaders. And these are people that every theologian studies. These would be people like St. Augustine, who concluded that non-believers should actually be tortured. Go ahead, one more. These would be people like St. Thomas Aquinas, who concluded that non-believers should be killed. Once more. St. Thomas More, who tortured people for reading or owning the Bible in English. Once more. And the father of modern Christianity, Martin Luther, who's author of a book on the Jews and their lies, which I think succinctly wraps up the anti-Semitic history of organized Catholicism and Christianity. But this is true Christianity as a matter of doctrine throughout history. What makes the modern moderate think they have an effortless bead on true Christianity while these people didn't? Trust me when I say these people had read the New Testament. All right, go ahead and advance one more. Oh, okay, advance one more. The thing is, there's 34,000 different versions of Christianity according to the World Christian Encyclopedia, each one of them claiming to have their own version of faith-based truth. If we ever needed a reason to believe that faith is an immeasurably poor means of discerning one truth claim from the next, this is it. It should be clear to us that there are not... Okay. As long as my beliefs don't hurt anybody. If you look at exit polls from various votes on moral issues, abortion, gay rights, I'm sure we all know that that religious belief correlates to voting a particular way. This is because the existence of God has bearings on what is moral, just like our zombie example, just like Madeline Karen Newman. And we have a problem here, is that we have two groups. We have several groups wanting to have the moral discussion, saying, our morality is right, we should legislate on my morality. But we're really, really lackadaisical at having the reality discussion. And this has frozen us in a kind of schism that we can't get out of, because so many of us are loath to criticize faith. Go ahead and advance. All right. Now, on an individual level, it's very, very possible that someone can have completely absurd ideas and we can all get along. I have no problem admitting that. The problem is, once you spread it out on a societal level and start saying, we don't have an epistemological responsibility, we don't have an obligation to have good reasons for what we believe, then you're giving license to anybody, to really any belief, since faith can be used to support any belief. Go ahead and advance. So societally, we can't really have that. Advance one more. All right. Let's move on to religion gives people hope. Hope, obviously, does not equate to truth at all. It doesn't matter how tantalizing a proposition is, it has no bearing on what is true. And I'll give you an example of this. Go ahead and advance one. All right. There's a difference between hoping you have won the lottery, go ahead and advance twice, and believing you have actually won the lottery. Go ahead and advance. And what's more, if you fail your epistemological responsibility and believe you've won the lottery in error, you're going to have some financial problems for a really long time, because you probably bought a house or two. All right, go ahead and advance. Okay, imagine another situation. When people say religion gives us hope, imagine that there's an asteroid heading towards the Earth. And every 200 million years on average, this happens. The Earth gets struck by an asteroid of sufficient size to wipe out most of the life. Let's take hope as an approach to this asteroid in two different ways. In one sense, you could say hope is shutting your eyes, imagining this asteroid's never going to hit us, and calling it good. This seems to be the hope that religious people want to find. By believing we get everything back after we're dead, we go to heaven, excellent. The problem is that's not really hope, because it doesn't change anything. However, if we have the fortitude to look at reality and admit that sometimes reality sucks. Sometimes the truth of the world is not what we want it to be. But if we acknowledge it and we have the fortitude to do so, we can change it. We can start applying our mind to fixing the problem. And that is far more of a hope than ignoring it will ever, ever be. Go ahead and advance. One of these has the answer to our meteor. I'll leave it to you to decide which. Okay, and go ahead and advance one real quick. Since I was talking about meteors and destroying the world, and this is going on YouTube, I'm just trying to help myself out for next year. Go ahead and advance. And a special sorry for PZ there. I feel like I'm betraying Ferengula. All right, go ahead and advance one more. All right, that's a really discreet around my hair. Okay. What's more, the hope of religion isn't really, you know, a better hope than a world without a god. Because if you want to live forever, if you even want to live longer, acknowledging the world for what it is the way to go. You know, perhaps one day we can fuse silicon with our skin, or make our bones out of titanium. It's an offshoot, but it would help us live longer, far more than just closing our eyes and hoping we go somewhere else when we die. What's more, the hope of religion, you know, especially in Christianity, is a situation where you have to give up a tremendous portion of your life, kneeling and groveling, living in shame. And that's not really a hope. It's a waste of life. What's more, it's very ineffectual cowardice. Unless you can produce a reason to believe that God exists. Unless you have a good argument for that. Because then you can base your moral decision on something that has to do with reality. Go ahead and advance one. All right. We'll have to agree to disagree. And the answer is no. We can't afford to do that. Because if we agree to disagree, we can never reconcile our moral differences. We can't have the discussion about what is moral to do without first having the discussion about what is real. And if we try to have the moral discussion without deciding what is real, as Dr. Carrier said at the end of the pro-debate, we're just going to wind up getting in each other's way. So go ahead and advance. Twice. All right. Several different moral decisions have to do with whether or not a God exists. These have to do with allocation of resources. The Bible has several prescriptions for where our resources are supposed to go or who's supposed to get, you know, certain pieces of land. One more, please. All right. Equal rights for particular demographics. Gay people. Remember what I said about exit polls from moral issues like gay marriage? We all know which way religious people tend to vote. One more, please. All right. What we should teach in science class. Intelligent design, right, PZ? Oh, big no on that one. Okay. One more, please. All right. Who should live and who should die? Eye for an eye, tooth for a tooth? If God exists and he's going to punish us for disobeying his word, that's an important fact to hammer out. Otherwise, we can never get on the same page morally. One more, please. And you can imagine there's just tons more on this list. I'm just highlighting a few of them. Advance one more, please. All right. The truth of the matter is that we live in a democratic society. We have to make the decisions of what we ought and ought not to do as a team, which means we all have to be on the same page. Once more, please. So once more, we'll have to agree to disagree. No. This is just something that people use to get around the burden of reason, to get around having to give reasons for what they believe. And we can't afford to let them do it. One more, please. All right. Nothing you can ever say will change my mind. Go ahead, one more time. Yeah, one more, please. Yeah, it's not really over. One more. Have you chosen to believe the earth is round? I mean, think about it. If I told you that I had a water bottle here or a rock, and you believed I was infinitely wealthy, which for a student is a pretty hard thing to imagine. For a music student, it's even worse. And for a heretic in the Midwest, it's really hard. But imagine I'm made of money. I've got all the money in the world. And I've told you that I'll give you $1 million. And all you have to do is believe that when I drop this rock, it's going to fly up to the ceiling rather than fall down to the ground. And we could imagine we could hook you up to a machine that could tell what you really believed. Even for $1 million, could you believe that the rock would fall up rather than down? Knowing what I know about the human brain, I'm willing to wager you couldn't. And that's just the point. It doesn't matter how enticing a proposition is. It has nothing to do with it. Our brains are constrained by what we take in about the world. We do not choose our beliefs, which is really weird that any religion would demand that we do. I mean, I can't choose that anybody rose from the dead any more than I can choose to believe that a dropped rock will fall upwards. Go ahead and advance again. So the man walked on water, rose from the dead. Advance one more, please. All the people who read my blog and think that I'm this huge asshole definitely couldn't do that. But the thing is, when they say nothing you can ever say will change my mind, it's simply not true. They've just managed to avoid learning enough about the universe to realize that there's no appeal to God necessary to explain any of it. We have to force them to look at it. And when I say force them, I'm not saying we should barge into their churches, barge into their homes, put a gun to their head and say, you know, read an astronomy textbook. What I am saying is that when they exit the private and enter into the public, because we all have this epistemological responsibility and allowing people to avoid it has consequences, we have to hold their feet to the fire. We have to be prepared, we have to be informed, and we have to be able to answer for ourselves and explain it to them. Because once people start thinking, just once the gears start turning for the first time and they think, I don't need God to make a star. I don't need God to be moral. I've often found that from there, nature does the rest. It's just the way the world works. It's the way the brain works. Go ahead and advance one more, please. All right. Life would be meaningless, and there would be no beauty without belief in God. All right. We don't necessarily have to have an overarching significance. We may not have one. I don't think we do. I mean, we're molecules. We're atoms. However, that doesn't mean we can't determine purpose for our own life. You being here is a purpose. You came here for a reason. Me standing here trying to convince you that what I'm saying is the truth, that's a purpose. Going and watching the moon set, go ahead and advance. Going and watching the, advance one more. Watching the moon set over a lake is a purpose. If you feel moved to do it, that's a purpose. How beautiful would this be if you weren't there to think it was beautiful? That's a purpose. Go ahead and advance one more, please. All right, and advance one more. We don't need to muddle beauty or mystery with contradiction. We don't. The atheist, the scientist, has appreciation for mystery. We love mystery. Trying to solve mysteries is one of the things that occupies in life. We don't need to add contradictions to the equation. And I put this up here. This is a great quote. It establishes that art that moves us can really be simplified. You can actually simplify it, Michelangelo's David, beyond hammer hits. Beyond that, it's just atoms. It's just molecules, just arranged a particular way. But we have no problem saying that a painting is beautiful or a statue is beautiful, even if it's just atoms and molecules arranged. People are the same way. We can find beauty and meaning in our lives without needing, you know, God to bestow it upon us. Go ahead and advance one more, please. Oh, yeah. It's a true story. The Google gods smile. Okay, one more. All right. And my last one, you're a jerk face. And, you know, the truth of the matter is, go ahead and advance, is maybe I am. It's very, very feasible. The crux of the matter, though, is it all depends on what is true. Because if there is no God, and people who are beholden to religious reasoning are doing harm on a societal level to our country, our planet, their fellow man, if they're absolving themselves of their epistemological responsibility unfairly, then I'm not a jerk face. I'm actually a teacher, a rescuer of sorts, as are any of you who would do the same thing. Of course, if God does exist, then I'm condemning people to hell with my actions, and to call me a jerk face would make you a master of understatement. But it all depends on what is true. And the thing is, if you ask me, JT, why do you believe a certain thing? I'll defend it. I won't have to invoke faith. I won't have to say we'll have to agree to disagree. I won't have to use any of these arguments I spent the last half hour going through. I'll explain it. Try that of a pastor sometime, or a priest. See if they can do the same thing. Say, how do you know that? This was PZ's talk last year, and he reiterated this several times. How do you know that? The atheist shouldn't have to resort to any of these things. Go ahead and advance one more, please. Or not. One more, please. The thing is, so often people of faith remain in faith. They create these caves where they can hide away from reason. And it's not only sad that people feel they need to hide away from reason, but there are liabilities to it. Liabilities that affect you, they affect me, they affect, you know, entire demographics, they affect our planet. And it all boils down to reason. It all boils down to what is true, and it all boils down to people of faith trying to circumvent the discussion of what is true. And we can't let them keep doing it. The stakes are too high, and there's too much at stake. Thank you.